Who is a healthy subject? Well, the answer sometimes looks very much easy and very much difficult also. So the reason is that because you will not find any guideline which clearly define who is a healthy subject in a clinical trial. Now this is important because in a clinical trial, whenever there is a patient population, then you will have multiple criteria that will define how the patient should be diagnosed and what kind of laboratory parameter should be examined before confirming his or her eligibility in the clinical trial. But whenever it is about the healthy subject, then typically inclusion and exclusion criteria, they don't define how to identify a healthy subject. So today's discussion will be based on defining some set of criteria that will help a safety physician or a medical writer or a clinical research associate to define who is a healthy subject and to confirm their eligibility in the trial. And also it will ensure during the clinical trial that healthy subject safety and well-being is maintained. So a paper published in European Journal of Clinical Pharmacology, it mentions that a consensus was achieved among various stakeholders on a standardized approach for the evaluation of healthy subject before enrollment in phase 1 trial and also during dosing. And it was believed that this consensus will help sponsors, investigators and the clinical trial staff to further improve subjects' safety, and it will also facilitate interaction with the various regulatory bodies concerning various key safety issues in the phase 1 trial. So it all started with one of the most recent tragedy which happened in first in human trial of newly developed FAH inhibitor. Now what happened in this study, a healthy subject died in the multiple ascending dose part of this trial. So there were total 6 subjects in this study, and after 5 administration, one of the patient got a serious condition and because of which he was hospitalized. But investigator did not consider this as a possible relationship. So he continued remaining 5 patients on the 6th dose. Now what happened, after giving the 6th dose in the remaining 5 patients, these 5 also get hospitalized. And the first one who was hospitalized died. So because of this issue, trial was suspended. So after this recent tragedy, so many discussion happened, and it was decided that there should be focus on stopping rule in a clinical trial, because if there were adequate stopping rules, then this tragedy could have prevented. And it was also decided that there is a need for inclusion and exclusion criteria which will define a healthy population. So with this focus, a consensus was developed, which we will see in the subsequent slide. Now in literature, different definition on health and the healthy volunteer exist. WHO defines health, whereas the Royal College of Physicians and the textbook of pharmaceutical medicine, it defines healthy volunteer. But the interesting part is that this definition do not provide an answer how health can be ensured before and during the course of clinical trial in healthy subject. So it is then decided that there should be an acceptable normal ranges for various key safety parameters like cardiovascular safety parameters, heart rate, blood pressure and ECG, as well as certain laboratory parameters like renal function test and the liver function test. And there is also need for a timing and frequency of the safety assessment. And there is also need to define an adequate stopping rule that could have prevented the death which has happened in this tragedy. Healthy subjects are usually enrolled in 2 types of clinical trial. The one is first in human trial, where the substances are not clinically established, and others is a bioequivalence trial, which are conducted in those medicines which are already established clinically. Now both of these trial, whenever we talk about screening examination, then there is a time window. It has been said that in case of first in human trial, the laboratory values and the eligibility criteria, it should be evaluated within 3 days prior to screening. If there are more than 3 days, then there should be reassessment. Whereas in case of clinical established investigational product, it has been said that usually screening should be conducted between 1 to 21 days before screening day. However, in some of the cases, it has been also recommended that the approach can be risk adapted. Now in the subsequent trial, subsequent slides, we will see that what is the value of key cardiovascular parameter like heart rate, ECG and blood pressure, which is acceptable and which will define a healthy adult. Now when we talk about heart rate, in both first in human trial as well as in those trial like bioequivalence, the limit of heart rate which is recommended is between 50 to 90. If the patient is not having any other cardiovascular or other abnormality, then some stakeholder also consider heart rate between 50 to 45. Whereas in case of bioequivalence, some experts also recommend heart rate less than 45 if the other cardiological examinations are normal. Now the reason for this is because a minor variation in heart rate is acceptable and it is seen in the healthy subject, because one of the study has documented that sinus bradycardia is not uncommon in healthy subject. It was seen in the study that sinus bradycardia, it was present at baseline in 8% of subject who was exposed to placebo, and this may be possibly due to physiological changes in the vagal tone, diurnal variation or the effect of food intake. Similar is true for ECG also. Now in case of ECG, in one of the study where placebo was given to the subject, it was seen that conduction abnormality was there in around 6% of the subject, wherever the rhythm abnormality was there in the 13% of the subject. In another study, there were 43% of the subject whose basal ECG was normal, but whenever they were exposed to placebo, this 43% subject got abnormality in ECG. And vice versa, there were 45% of the subject whose baseline ECG was abnormal, but over a fixed period of time, their ECG becomes normal. So basically it means that minor abnormality in healthy subjects ECG, it occurs frequently. And similar is also true for key lab values like hepatic parameter and the renal parameter, that we will see in the next slide. Now, if we discuss the same acceptable normal ranges for key laboratory parameters, then in first in human trial as well as in bioequivalence trial, the relative hepatic and renal parameters are ALT, AST, bilirubin, creatinine and the GFR. Now, in case of first in human trial, this relevant parameter, it should not exceed upper level of normal limit. But in case of bioequivalence trial, slight elevation is acceptable, like 10% for ALT and 20% for AST or bilirubin. In case of renal parameter, 10% elevation is acceptable. Now there is a reason behind giving this relaxation, because it has been observed that whenever healthy subjects are exposed to placebo, then elevation in hepatic and renal parameter is seen around 10% of subject. And when we combine and when we compare this observation with ECG and heart rate, where we have seen that minor abnormality in heart rate and minor abnormality in ECG in healthy subjects occurs frequently. So when we take together this observation, it suggests that the changes compared to the baseline or screening parameter, it have to be interpreted very much carefully, because they do not necessarily reflect adverse reaction induced by a drug, and it can be due to either spontaneous variation, placebo effect, or may reflect the trial condition. So with this point, here we are finishing about the acceptable normal ranges for key safety parameter. Now in the next slide, we will discuss about the adequate stopping rule which can prevent a catastrophic trial. Now it has been recommended that a protocol should define adequate stopping rule for individual subject, cohort, as well as termination of entire trial. and this stopping rule should be based on coding adverse event and laboratory abnormality according to CTCA criteria or some grade. Now when we talk about this criteria, it says that if anybody develop one adverse event of severe intensity, then trial can be stopped in the individual subject. Trial can also be stopped if an individual subject develop a serious adverse event or certain relevant sign or symptom which will affect the subject's safety. Now in case of cohorts, when to stop of further dose escalation? It can be stopped when more than or equal to 50% of subject of the preceding dose step experienced adverse event of moderate or severe intensity, which can be considered to be drug related. If there is a serious adverse event which is a drug related, then also stop of further dose escalation is recommended. Now when to terminate entire trial? So it has been said that decision should be taken by mutual agreement between investigator and the sponsor. So now if we talk about the summary of this entire discussion, then it says that protocol should define acceptable normal ranges for key safety parameter. Now in case of heart rate, the heart rate between 50 to 90 is recommended, and if the patient is not having any other clinically significant condition or a cardiological examination, then in case of generic bioequivalence trial, heart rate less than 45 is also acceptable. In case of ECG, minor abnormalities like rhythm abnormalities and conduction defect are seen in the healthy subject and it is acceptable. Now in case of lab parameter like liver and kidney, in case of first in human trial, key liver parameter, the limit should not exceed upper level of normal limit. In case of generic study, some relaxation is given, like 10% elevation in liver and renal parameter is acceptable. Now regarding timing and frequency of safety assessment, it has been told that at the time of screening, if the trial is first in human trial, then screening should be of within 3 days. Whereas in case of generic study, a screening up to 21 days is also acceptable. For stopping rule, it has been said that for individual patient, if a patient develop a severe grade of adverse event or a serious adverse event, then trial should be stopped in that subject. In case of dose escalation, it has been said that whenever more than 50% of the subject developed a serious adverse event of grade 2 or grade 3 intensity, and if it is a drug related and this developed as a preceding dose, then the further dose escalation is not recommended. Further dose escalation is also not recommended if there is any one serious adverse event which is a drug related. So I believe that today's discussion will help you to write down adequate stopping rules, also to define inclusion and the exclusion criteria which will define a healthy population. So friends, if you have liked this video, then you can click like button, and if you want to subscribe this video, then I would like to request you, please click the subscribe button. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.